Good evening, everyone. As Eileen told you, my name is Ann Burke, and on behalf of the Illinois Supreme Court Historic Preservation Commission and my colleagues on the Illinois Supreme Court, I welcome all of you to the Union Theater, Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum, and to an event that will be sure to entertain and to educate. I'd like to begin, first of all, by thanking the entire Alton Trial Committee of the Illinois Supreme Court Historic Preservation Commission for their tireless in preparing the script and actors for tonight's performance. Last evening, we had an outstanding trial and presentation in Godfrey, near Alton, on the Lewis and Clark Community College campus in the Hathaway Cultural Center. This evening's event involves 7 trials in the Madison County Circuit Court and 5 appeals in the Illinois Supreme Court from 1897 to 1908. The Illinois Supreme Court continued the precedent set by earlier court decisions that repeatedly upheld an Illinois statute that prohibited the segregation of public schools. From a legal perspective, tonight we will learn about the role of the writ of mandamus, probably made most famous by the United States Supreme Court case of Marbury versus Madison, in which Chief Justice John Marshall asserted the right of judicial review. The presentation that you will see this evening combines the law with different community spirit that drove these lawsuits. The topic of community is extremely important because it was the galvanizing force behind Scott Bibb that supported his fight for equal educational opportunities for his children for 11 years. After the presentation, we will hear a panel discussion with members of the local community and from the legal profession to help put the presentation into context. And I'd like to thank Scott Zala, the Vice Chair of the Alton School Cases Executive Committee, for his tireless efforts and unending work as ordered by the court on the panel discussion portion of tonight's event. These discussions help put the social and legal issues in perspective that help us to understand the case better. Our Alton School case experience tonight is the 4th in a series of annual trial events sponsored by the Illinois Supreme Court and Historic Preservation Commission and many partners like the Abraham Lincoln Library and Museum. Our primary purpose for these trials and hearings is to educate the public about historical issues that pertain to our modern day lives. By studying our past, we learn about our present and gather the necessary information to make informed decisions about the future. Law and society are interwoven and demonstrate that the law is a living, breathing mechanism that reflects change over time. Perhaps our state's favorite son and lawyer, Abraham Lincoln, said it best during an oral argument in a lawsuit in 1855. He said that legislation and adjudication must follow and conform to the progress of society. Equally important is the opportunity to educate our students about history and law. And with our partnership with the Illinois State Board of Education, we are able to create curricula materials on the Mary Todd Lincoln insanity case, the Joseph Smith habeas corpus cases, and on Lincoln, race, and slavery. All of these curricula materials will be available for teachers on the Board of Education website and on the Commission's website. So our effort this evening joins history and the law to understand Illinois' legal system and its rich history. Our court records show personal conflict, economic issues, family dynamics, social issues, and dispute resolution. These records provide us with an incredible window into life at any given time period. The Alton School Cases are our window into Alton at the turn of the 20th century. I hope you all will enjoy the presentation. Thank you for listening.
The Elijah Lovejoy Monument, erected in Alton, Illinois, and dedicated on November 8, 1897, the 60th anniversary of his death. It took a little while to get everyone on board.
The Reverend Elijah Parrish Lovejoy was pastor of a Presbyterian church and publisher of the St. Louis Observer. As a white man who witnessed a mob burning a slave at the stake, he was called to conscience and published editorials in his paper advocating the abolition of slavery. Citizens of the slave state of Missouri responded by attacking the Observer's offices and destroying his press.
Reverend Lovejoy decided to move his family and business to the safety of Alton in the free state of Illinois. However, when a boat carrying his press up the Mississippi arrived in July 1836, a group of men boarded the ship, broke up the press, and threw the pieces into the river.
Alton's most prominent businessmen provided Lovejoy with the support to purchase a new press and establish the Alton Observer.
On the night of August 21st, 1837, Reverend Lovejoy was confronted by a mob who entered the office of the Observer and destroyed the new printing press.
When a third press arrived, only a month later, a dozen men with their faces covered broke apart the new press and again tossed the remains into the Mississippi.
When a fourth press was ordered, a committee of citizens gathered and passed a resolution that Lovejoy stop publishing and leave Alton.
Lovejoy responded by addressing the body.
Now, why should I flee from Alton? Is this not a free state? The very act of retreating will embolden the mob to follow me wherever I go. No, sir, there was no way of escaping the mob but to abandon the path of duty, and that, God helping me, I will never do.
The night after the fourth press arrived, a mob of armed and drunken men threatened Lovejoy and his supporters guarding the press.
When the mob set fire to the warehouse, Reverend Lovejoy and two supporters went outside to extinguish the flames. But members of the mob fired their guns, and Lovejoy was hit.
While Lovejoy breathed his last, vigilantes broke apart the printing press and once again threw the pieces into the dark waters of the Mississippi.
2 days later, on what would have been his 35th birthday, Elijah Lovejoy was laid to rest.
The national outrage over Reverend Lovejoy's assassination proved to be a turning point in garnering support for the movement to abolish slavery.
Just months later, a young Abraham Lincoln alluded to Lovejoy's murder in a speech at the Springfield Lyceum.
Whenever the vicious portion of population shall be permitted to gather in bands of hundreds and thousands and burn churches, ravage and rob provision stores, throw printing presses into rivers, shoot editors, and hang and burn obnoxious persons at pleasure and with impunity, depend on this. This government cannot last.
Hard times came to Alton in the years after Lovejoy's murder. The economy collapsed, property values fell, and businesses moved away. Some attributed the city's struggles to the ignominy that resulted from the actions of the Alton mob.
So 60 years later, on November 8, 1897, at the base of this grand memorial, we invited, as an act of unification, all the citizens of Alton to gather together to dedicate this monument.
But some citizens chose not to attend the dedication ceremony.
Because this grand sculpture was not the first edifice in Alton that was dedicated to honor Reverend Lovejoy that year.
In September of 1897, just 2 months before the dedication of the monument, the Alton Board of Education opened two new schools.
One named for the black abolitionist leader, Frederick Douglass, and the other for Alton's white martyr to the cause, the Reverend Elijah P. Lovejoy.
These schools were built despite the 1870 Illinois Constitution and subsequent statutes providing for free public schools for all children. In particular, the statute passed in 1874.
Mm-hmm, that reads, all boards of school directors, boards of education, or school officers are prohibited from excluding, directly or indirectly, any such child from such school on account of the color of such child.
Two new schools built to segregate our colored children into separate schools.
Schools named for Frederick Douglass and Elijah P. Lovejoy.
The actions of the sworn officials of the city disrupt the two-decade practice of integrated schools in Alton.
These offenses galvanize the African-American citizens of Alton, who respond with
sit-ins, boycotts,
and a series of seven trials from 1898 to 1908 that resulted in two hung juries and five decisions that rise to appeals before the Supreme Court of the state of Illinois.
The lawsuits were brought in the name of Scott Bibb,
a father and a fireman at the Alton Glass Works.
At the first trial, a jury of 12 found that the officials had not acted illegally.
So Scott Bibb appealed the decision,
which was heard at the Illinois Supreme Court in 1899.
Oyez, oyez, the Honorable Supreme Court of Illinois is called to order. This action is brought by the people on the relation of Scott Bibb for a writ of mandamus.
A writ or order that is issued from a higher tier court that commands a lower tier court, corporation, municipal corporation, or individual to perform or refrain from performing a particular act, the performance or omission of which is required by law as an obligation.
A writ of mandamus against the mayor and members of the Common Council of the City of Alton, to compel them to admit the children of the relator to the Washington School, or the most convenient of the public schools of said city to which they have the right to be admitted, without excluding them or either of them on account of their color or descent.
Records indicate that the testimony at the seven trials was essentially the same. The roster of witnesses varied little, and the content of their testimony was consistent.
The presentation of the testimony you will hear tonight is selected from the 1904, 1906, and 1908 trial testimony, briefs, and judicial decisions.
While the testimony and arguments quote from the written record, we will also, for the sake of clarity and brevity, use exchanges outside of the courtroom, which we have invented based on the known facts and circumstances of these events.
Sources include quotations from newspapers of the day, representing the voices of both white and African-American communities.
In particular, the Illinois Record, published in Springfield by the Afro-American League. Its weekly column with news from Alton united the black community throughout the state by providing information often ignored by the mainstream press.
Some of the language of our time may fall hard on your contemporary ears, but it is preserved to convey the tenor of the times.
And two times we've replaced a word we just didn't see the need for.
The initial witness called was the relator.
The individual upon whose complaint the proceedings are called.
Scott Bibb.
Questioned initially by his attorney.
John J. Brenholt.
A former mayor of Alton.
And the only prominent white of the city on record supporting the efforts to fight the segregation of the schools.
How old are you, Mr. Bibb?
I am 49 years old.
How long have you lived in Alton?
Well, since 1863, when I first come to Alton.
Of what parentage were you born?
Colored.
I will ask you, Mr. Bibb, if you were a slave.
I was.
I will ask you if you are married.
Yes, sir.
What is your wife as to color?
She is a colored lady.
I will ask you if you are the party that filed the petition in this case.
Yes, sir, I am.
I will ask you now to state what you know, if anything, with regard to your children, Ambrose and Minnie Bibb, attending school in the city of Alton in September 1897.
Well, I sent them to the Washington School, and they were refused admission. They came back home with a card assigning them to go to the Lovejoy School.
Who had the card?
Ambrose had the card. He is my son. Mm-hmm. And I sent him back to the Washington School where he formerly went to, and he came back home. Well, I went with him over the next morning to see what the trouble was. Mm-hmm. I met Mr. Laughlin there. He had the habit of working at the Illinois Glass Works where I work. He was a policeman. He told me that he didn't care to come up to that school because I sent my children there. We were old friends and we worked together. But he told me he had to do it. He was ordered to do it. He said, I hate to turn my back on you, Scott, but I have to do this. I am ordered here by Mayor Brueggeman to keep the coloreds out of the public schools. Mm-hmm.
Did he say where the colored children should go?
Well, they wanted to send my son to the Lovejoy School, the one closest of the two SNU schools, but I went back to that Washington school for 2 weeks or more in succession.
Yeah.
What children went into the Washington school while you were there those 2 weeks?
Oh, the white children. The policemen were there to keep the colored children out.
Mm. How far is the Lovejoy School from your house?
About a mile and a half away.
How far is the Washington School?
Oh, about 3 blocks away.
What school would your children have to pass to get to the Lovejoy or Douglas School?
Oh, well, they would have to pass right by the Washington School.
The witness was cross-examined by
Elliot Breeze Glass,
the attorney defending the Alton officials. A graduate of Shirtliff College, Glass had served as state's attorney, mayor of Edwardsville, and president of the Edwardsville Board of Education.
Were you there the first morning that these children of yours received the cards?
No, sir, I wasn't.
Then all you know about that is what you have been told?
Well, I went over there the second morning.
Now, the first morning you went there, there was considerable excitement going on about the schoolyard?
No, sir. Well, there was some children there, but there were some neighborhood white people around, too.
Well, isn't it a fact that most of the people who were there that morning talking with the police and the young scholars about the schoolhouse were colored people?
Oh, no, sir. There were a good many white people there, neighboring white people from around there.
Right, right.
Did your children ever go to any of the two schools known as Lovejoy or Douglas schools?
The Washington school was the nearest school.
Oh, please answer my question. Did your children ever go to any of the two schools known as Lovejoy or Douglas schools?
No, sir.
Why not?
Because I didn't intend to send them there, Mr. Glass.
Why didn't you intend to send them there?
Because it was a mile and a half out of the way, and as I said, I wasn't going to send them there.
Why would the city council throw out a school system that's been doing just fine for 25 years? Our kids have been in classrooms with the white children almost since the end of the Civil War.
I think it's because they're trying to sell houses over here to white folks from St. Louis.
Mm.
But when they hear our schools are integrated, they run right off.
Well, the principal said it's because there's not enough space in the building.
There's an empty room upstairs in the Washington school.
Mm.
I went up there and looked.
They want to make it separate but equal. You think it's a coincidence the Alton City Council passed the ordinance to change the school district just 3 months after the U.S. Supreme Court gave segregation the okay?
Mm-mm. Plessy versus Ferguson? But wasn't that about train cars?
They mentioned schools in their opinions. Pretty much approved it.
Mm-hmm.
And just 3 months later, the mayor made plans to segregate the schools here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's a coincidence.
Mm-mm. And Harry Coates said,
those new schools aren't as good as any of the schools in Alton by one half. Mm-hmm.
Does the city want to annex Upper Alton?
Hightown.
Mm-hmm.
They segregated their high school in 1886.
Yeah, don't expect they'd join Alton if our schools stay integrated.
Mm. But that case went to the Illinois Supreme Court back in 1889. Mm. They said it was against the Illinois law to segregate the schools.
Mm-hmm. Didn't seem to change the way they were doing things in Upper Alton.
Same up in McLean County. The 8th Judicial District said the school district couldn't build a new school for only the black children.
That's right.
They did it anyway.
Mm.
Case went up in the Illinois Supreme Court, 1874. Court said that school was illegal.
Mm.
Yeah. The state legislature passed the act to protect colored children in their rights to attend public schools to stop those Jim Crow schools.
Mm-hmm. Over in Quincy, 1882. Mm. The Illinois Supreme Court said their rule requiring all colored pupils attend their own school violated just that statute. This is what the court said. whether our Illinois Constitution and the acts of the legislature passed in pursuance of it, which place all children, regardless of color, upon a perfect equality so far as admission into the public schools is concerned, are to be regarded as wise or unwise legislation, is a matter with which courts have no concern. We are bound to declare the law as we find it written, and if it is not satisfactory to any section of the state, the remedy is in the legislative department of the government, and there alone.
That's strong words.
Mm-hmm. Did it change anything?
Some, but they've still got a black school there.
Please state your name for the court.
Ambrose Bibbs, my name, Mr. Brenhall.
What is your age?
I'll be 16 my next birthday.
Yeah. Whereabouts in what vicinity do you live of the Washington Schoolhouse?
I live 3 blocks northeast of there.
How long have you lived in that place?
All my life.
How many of your family attended the Washington School in September 1897 or attempted to attend?
2.
Who was the other?
My sister, Minnie Bibb.
And what grade was she in?
The 2nd grade.
How old was she at the time?
Well, I was 9 years old, so she was 7 years old at the time.
What pupils went to the Washington School prior to 1897 with you, if you know, as to color?
Whites and blacks both.
Right.
Have
right.
you the That's school admission card in your pocket?
Yes, sir.
I will ask you where you obtained this card.
My teacher, Miss Mary Crawford.
When?
June 1897. Yeah.
What was the purpose of this card if she said something to you?
That admitted me to a higher grade in the fall.
I will ask you what other children got those cards, if you know, at the Washington School.
All those in my room got those cards.
Who got them with reference to color?
Whites and blacks both got them.
I will ask you now what you did, if anything, with reference to attending Washington School in September 1897.
We went there. My sister Minnie and I the first day.
What did you do and see there?
Well, we were permitted to enter the school, and we were given new cards assigning us to the Lovejoy School.
What did you do on the 2nd day?
We went back to the Washington School.
What happened?
Well, we were given permission to enter the schoolroom, and a teacher there told us we'd have to go back to the school assigned to us on the cards that we were given the day before.
To whom did she give these cards of assignment?
To the colored children.
Right.
How many did she give to whites, if you know?
I never seen her give any to the whites.
What was the condition of the Washington School as to having room in it when you were there in September 1897?
Well, there was plenty of room in my class.
What did you do the next morning?
We went back.
Now then, what did you find there?
Police officers were there.
What did they say to you?
They told us we couldn't enter.
What did the policemen do with reference to the white children that came there?
They let them enter the classroom.
Mm. What did you do next?
We went back the 4th morning and police officers were there again.
Who went with you to the schoolhouse?
My father.
Yeah, that's right.
How many times did he go there with you?
He went for 3 weeks.
Yes. I returned to that school where my son and daughter had attended so that the principals and the teachers would see that we had not forgotten nor given up.
Comprising only 7% of the Alton population, we knew we had no power to bring change through the ballot box.
So, we set about to be as visible and vocal as we could. To organize our efforts, the men of the community formed the Alton Citizens Committee and selected Harry B. Coates to be our president.
I have been authorized by the colored citizens to state that we will not attend those segregated schools, and we will contest this matter in the highest courts.
Harry Coates led our group to a meeting in Springfield with the former governor and state senator, John Palmer.
Who agreed to join Counselor Brenholt in providing legal advice.
We will not abide any illegal scheme. We ask no favor of the board. All we demand is our rights.
Now, we have agreed not to send our children to the segregated public school, but to teach them at home or in private schools.
If the truant officer should arrest colored people because their children do not attend Douglas and Lovejoy schools, the burden of proof will rest entirely with the Board of Education.
The resolve of the community is so strong that after 3 months, only 15 of our 145 colored children have ignored the boycotts and enrolled in the new schools.
Yes.
Though our suit was filed under my name, our work required the support of many in our community, both in our organization and in the courtroom.
Please give your name for the jury.
James Brock.
George Cross.
Robert White.
What is your business?
Barber.
Mr. Cross?
My business at the present time is a smelter at the Federal Lead Company.
Well, at the present time, I'm a saw filer at the Illinois Box Factory. Used to be a sawyer, but I got to be a saw filer a year or so ago.
How many children did you have of school age in September 1897?
Two daughters, Florence and Ella.
One, Raphael.
I will ask you where your children attended school at that time.
My son went to the Washington School.
Garfield.
The Irving School.
How far did you live from that school, Mr. Brock?
Four blocks.
Do you know where the Lovejoy School is?
Yes, sir.
How far do you live from that school?
2.5 miles.
What would your children have to cross, if anything, to get to the Douglas School?
They would have to cross the streetcar line on State Street and also on Plaza Street, the O&A. The O&A main line comes down there, and they also have their railroad yards across the main track.
Mr. Cross, did you ever see the police at the school?
Well, I didn't visit the Washington School, but coming home from work one day, I passed the Humboldt School. I saw policeman Pack stationed at the entrance of the school gate. He said he was making the colored children go to the school they were assigned to.
I saw police officers at the Irving School keep our children out during the first week in September. The children marched up in line, and as they come up, the colored children were separated from the whites by the police.
Where did the white children go?
To the white schools where they always went.
What did the officers do with the colored children?
They kept them from going in. Kept them away, drove them away from the school.
Mm-hmm. Mr. White, what did you see or hear with reference to your son, Raphael, attending the Garfield School in September 1897?
I took him to Miss Harris, the principal of the school, and asked her if he would be admitted there, and she said no. I asked her why, and she said, according to her directions, no colored children should be admitted to the school. And I insisted on getting an answer and wanted to know her reasons. And she referred me to Mr. Fink, who was the president of the Board of Education.
What happened then?
I asked her where Mr. Fink could be found, and she said she didn't know. Well, we found Mr. Fink in the schoolhouse, the Garfield schoolhouse. We found him in the hall, and we had quite a talk with him about it.
Who had quite a talk with him about it?
Myself and Mr. Kiles and Mr. Jones. We got into quite a conversation with him, probably an hour or an hour and a half. We asked Mr. Fink a great many questions. I wanted to know why my boy wasn't allowed to go to school there. And he told me and the rest there that there had been two new schools built for the colored children, and the colored children would have to attend those other two schools, the Lovejoy and Douglas schools.
What else did Mr. Fink say to you and Mr. Jones and Mr. Kiles?
When we talked to him, we pressed him for a reason why my child wasn't allowed to go to school there. And one reason he said there wasn't enough room upstairs. I told him there was plenty of room upstairs. Lots of vacant seats. And he went up and was gone a little while, and he came back and said, you can send your boy in. The boy went to class, and I came away then.
How long did your son continue to go to school there?
I continued to send him there for 2 weeks.
How long did he recite, if you know?
He didn't recite at all.
Mr. Cross, I will ask you if you knew the mayor of Alton.
I knew him when I saw him.
In September 1897, what was his name?
Mr. Henry Brueggeman.
Did you have a conversation with him in reference to colored children attending public school in Alton?
I met him near the City Hall front door and asked why my child and the others couldn't be permitted to attend the public schools. He said there were two buildings built expressly for colored students, and they would have to go to those two schools that they were assigned to. I told him that I thought it was pretty hard for my child to go there because he'd been going to the Washington School. He said it made no difference. They would have to go to that school if it required the entire police force to make them go.
Mr. Cross, myself, and Mr. Walker were together when we met Mayor Brueggeman near the City Hall on 2nd Street. Mr. Cross said to him it wasn't hardly right. They were going to those schools together for the last 25 years, and now to separate them, he didn't see any cause for it. Mr. Brueggeman said to him it made no difference. They must go to the two schools built for them.
You may cross-examine, Mr. Glass.
Mr. Brock, could white children have gone to these two schools known as Douglas and Lovejoy and you not know it?
Yes, sir.
You never saw any children of any color prohibited from going to those schools, did you?
No, sir.
Isn't it a fact that the colored children in Alton didn't all have to cross the tracks to go to school? You say about all. What proportion of the colored children have to cross the tracks to go to school?
Some do.
Do you know whether all the children that you spoke of as colored children that were rejected at the Irving School and the Garfield and Washington schools have been going to any school since that time?
Well, some have and some are not going at all.
Isn't it a fact the majority have been going to public schools since?
No, sir, not the majority. There's probably one half of them, that's my opinion. Some are going to the Douglas School, but mine are going to the Catholic schools. And some are not going at all.
Mr. Cross, did you send your child to the Lovejoy School afterwards where he was assigned?
No, sir.
Why didn't you?
Well, it was further at the time. My son was small and not very healthy.
And how old was your child?
6 years old.
And 6 or 7 blocks was too far for him to go, in your opinion, to school?
Going from that neighborhood...
Isn't it a fact that the reason you didn't send your child to the Lovejoy School was because you wanted him to go to the Washington School? Was that not the reason?
No, sir, not the whole reason.
What is the other part of the reason?
Because there were children living in the immediate neighborhood with my child, and they were going back to the same school, and I couldn't understand why my child couldn't go back, too.
That means about the same thing, don't it, Mr. Cross?
No, sir.
While the men of the Citizens Committee took the lead in the legal battle for our access to the schools, the women of Alton built the structure to sustain the fight.
Nettie Poindexter established a private school in her home to educate the children during the boycott.
The Ladies Committee was formed to make social arrangements, which served to solidify support for the cause.
The committee's membership provided connections to the community's churches,
such as the African Methodist Episcopal and the Union Baptist,
as well as membership organizations such as the Sisters of the Mysterious Ten and the Order of the Eastern Star.
And through our husbands and our brothers, we reached the members of the United Brothers of Friendship, the Knights of Pythias, and the G.T. Watson Masonic Lodge.
The Ladies Committee organized dinners, picnics, dances, and riverboat excursions to raise funds to pay the ongoing legal fees.
Our celebrations marked the important events of the year.
The 4th of July.
Emancipation Day.
Trains from Edwardsville, St. Louis, Springfield, and beyond brought African-Americans to Alton for the Elijah Lovejoy Club's annual
parade and picnic.
Come one and all, woo! Large and small. Everybody will find comfort and pleasure by simply putting in their appearance.
Yes.
And of course, after the grand concert and cakewalk is disposed of, the accomplished pianist, Miss Cordelia Jones, will take charge of the piano, and you all know the rest.
And that social pull bound the movement together and kept the boycott strong.
If you wanted to attend the dance, you might not be comfortable if you were sending your child to the segregated Lovejoy School or taking a job there.
Please state your name for the jury.
Florence Barber.
What is your occupation?
School teacher.
At what school?
Lovejoy School.
What school is that with reference to color?
Red brick building.
What is it as to the color of the students that go there?
Well, that is hard to tell.
Well, what are you as to color?
Well, I am colored.
Well, I will ask you, what is the color of the children that you teach at the Lovejoy School?
Well, they are various colors.
Are they not colored children?
Well, that is hard for me to tell because some of them have white mothers and some have white fathers.
Yes, are they not called colored children?
As I said before, that is hard for me to tell.
Do any white children go to that school?
Well, I don't know whether you consider them all colored or part white or not.
Will you name all the white children that attend the school you teach, the Lovejoy School?
Well, what that I spoke of having mixed blood.
Well, who are they? What are their names?
The Harding children.
Are they not colored?
Well, I don't know how to consider them. I mean, their mother is perfectly white and their father is colored.
Are they not called colored children?
Well, I can't say.
Isn't it a fact, Miss Barber, that some of the children attending your school, from outside appearances, are as white as ordinary white persons?
Yes, sir. I have had one case of that in my room.
Thank you.
The plaintiff rests.
To begin, the Alton officials deny the material allegations of discrimination. The Board of Education passed resolutions regarding the organization of the school districts in good faith and to alleviate school overcrowding. For the defense, the city of Alton calls Adolf Fink to the stand. Mr. Fink, what position did you occupy in September in 1897 in the city of Alton?
With reference to the school?
Yes, sir.
I was president of the Board of Education then.
Would you state whether or not on or about the 20th of September in 1897, you said to Robert White at the Garfield Schoolhouse, there had been two schools built for colored children and they would have to go there, or words to that effect?
No, sir.
Mr. Fink, on or about the 20th day of September in 1897 at the Garfield Schoolhouse in the city of Alton, did you say to David Kiles that he must send his boy to the school built for him, or words to that effect?
I didn't know him at all.
On or about the 20th day of September in 1897 at the Garfield School, did you state to David Kiles that you insist the colored children should go to the colored school?
No, sir.
Now, Mr. Fink, I will ask you to state if about the 20th day of September in 1897, if at your house in the city of Alton, you stated to Messrs. Joyner, Cross, and Coates that the colored children had to go to the colored schools and the Board of Education had requested the mayor to send the whole police force to do it, or words to that effect?
No, sir. How could
you may cross-examine.
Mr. Fink, did a committee consisting of Harry Coates, George Cross, Scott Bibb, and William Joyner call on you at your house in Alton in September 1897 with reference to children going to public school in Alton?
Yes, sir.
What conversation did you have with them? Was there any reference to children attending the public school in Alton?
Yes, sir.
Did you say to the committee Messrs. Scott, Coates, Bibb, and Joyner at the time spoke of that there had been two schools built for colored people, the Lovejoy and Douglas schools, and that they would have to go there?
No, sir.
Did you hear the question?
Yes, sir, I heard the question.
Did you meet Robert White in the Garfield School in September 1897?
I don't remember. I don't know White.
Did you have a conversation there in the presence of David Kiles at the time?
I don't know him.
Do you say you did not have a conversation with either Mr. Kiles or Mr. White in the Garfield Schoolhouse with reference to children going to public school in the city of Alton in September 1897?
No, sir.
I understand you to say you didn't know David Kiles or Robert White.
No, sir. I don't know them personally.
Well, how can you say you didn't meet them in the Garfield School in September 1897?
Because I never had any conversations in the Garfield School with any of them.
Did you meet any colored men in the Garfield Schoolhouse in September 1897?
I can't remember if I met anyone there or not. I can't remember after 6 years' time has elapsed.
Well, then you might have met Mr. Kiles and Mr. White and not remembered it.
I might have. I don't know. I don't remember. I can't tell. I might have met them.
We must stand together to fight those monsters of iniquity whose silence, with the power to act, means our certain ruin. We need money to pay lawyers, to advocate our rights in the courts, and to bring to justice every man that infringes upon our community school rights.
The Illinois Afro-American Protective League calls on every colored church in the state of Illinois to set apart a Sunday for the purpose of collecting money to aid and assist the Alton people to reestablish the colored children to their constitutional rights.
Mm-hmm. We're getting along as well as possible, considering the fact that only a faithful few of us have the load to bear.
Mass meetings to raise money to further the Alton school fight are becoming to get a common thing in Chicago. Mm-hmm. You can hear of one at least part of the city every night. Yeah.
We know positively of $8.35, which was collected by that big committee of 100 citizens in Chicago.
That's right.
But they have yet to turn it over to our Alton committee.
The citizens of St. Paul contributed $22.45, which shows they have more interest in the welfare of our boys and girls than we have ourselves. The citizens of Alton need money, and we need it bad. And everyone of color in this state should contribute at least 5 cents.
The Alton people are glad to know that our friends elsewhere are taking so much interest in this question.
But that interest comes from all corners. Editorials in the Edwardsville Intelligencer called on John Brenholt to explain his reasons for providing legal counsel for Scott Bibb and urged voters to turn Brenholt out if he chose to stand for re-election to the Illinois Senate.
And the St. Louis Star saluted Henry Brueggeman as the first mayor of Alton who dared to draw the color line.
Mayor Brueggeman, were you the mayor of the city of Alton in September in 1897?
Yes, sir.
I will ask you to state whether or not in September of 1897, in the city hall or in front of the city hall, that you said to James Brock and Alfred Walker and George Cross that there had been two buildings built expressly for colored children and they would have to go there, even if it required the whole police force?
No, sir. I never made such a statement.
I will ask you to state whether or not, in the latter part of the month of September in 1897, in your store in the city of Alton, you made the remark that you would send them coloreds to the schools that was built for them if it takes the whole police force. Or words to that effect.
No, sir, I did not.
Was David Kyles in your store at any time during the month of September in 1897?
No, sir, I don't think he was. Nor had he been there for several weeks or months before that.
Did you at any time during the month of September in 1897, in the presence of David Kyles in your store, make the remark that was just asked?
In my store?
Yes, sir, or words to that effect.
No, sir.
Did you ever instruct policemen in Alton, Illinois to prevent the colored children from going to school?
I did not.
Did you at any time order police to the schools?
No, sir.
I will ask you to state whether or not you ever issued any orders to the Board of Education with reference to excluding any colored children from the public schools of Alton.
No, sir. I never did issue an order for anything.
Mr. Brenholt.
I understand you to say you didn't have a conversation with George Cross at City Hall in September 1897.
I didn't say I didn't have a conversation with him. I denied the questions as they were put to me. I remember those people stopped to talk to me, but I didn't certainly say more than a word or two and passed on.
Then you did have a conversation with them.
I did.
About school matters?
No, sir. Not about school matters.
In your store in September 1897, didn't you say there that the colored children would have to go to a colored school prepared for them?
No, sir. I didn't say it.
You didn't say that to no one?
Not that I know of.
I understood you to say you never instructed the police to go to the schoolhouse. Well, how did they get there, if you know?
I don't know. I suppose they were directed there by authority.
By what authority?
I don't know. Unless it was the chief of police.
Testimony by these and other witnesses with no significant difference in evidence presented was litigated and heard by 7 juries over the course of a decade with the following results. In a jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1898, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict exonerating the Alton officials of any wrongdoing or violating the Illinois statutes. This verdict was appealed to the state of Illinois Supreme Court, where it was heard in 1899. The majority opinion was written by Justice Joseph Carter.
Manifest error prejudicial to Mr. Bibb occurred regarding admissibility of evidence. The trial court improperly refused to admit evidence that would have supported Mr. Bibb's charge of excluding his children from the Washington school on the basis of race alone. While it may be that the wisest of both races believed that the best interest of each would be promoted by a voluntary separation in the public schools, and while such voluntary action could not be interfered with by the courts, yet the law is plain for argument and has often been decided that no child otherwise entitled to attend any public school in this state can, on account of the color of such child, be excluded directly or indirectly from such school by any school officer or public authority. It is the duty of the mayor and the police to preserve the law. It is no less the duty of the courts to enforce the law as it now stands. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to submit the issues to another jury and to proceed in the case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the second jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1899, the vote of one juror prevented a unanimous decision exonerating the Alton officials, and the court declared a mistrial with orders for a new trial.
At the third jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1900, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict exonerating the Alton officials of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the state of Illinois, where it was heard in December of 1901. With Justice Ricks dissenting, the majority opinion was written by Justice John P. Hand.
The instruction given to the jury by the Circuit Court stating, if you believe the authorities of the city of Alton have the legal right to assign children to different schools without discrimination to color, your verdict should be in favor of the authorities, improperly asked the jury to find and determine legal propositions. Further, the Circuit Court improperly submitted to the jury the following question. Do you believe that equal and reasonable educational facilities were furnished to the children of Alton, irrespective of color and without discrimination? Under Illinois law, the city had no right to establish different schools for the white children and colored children of said city. The verdict is contrary to the manifest weight of the evidence and is against the law. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to submit the issues to another jury and to proceed in the case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the fourth jury trial of the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1902, the vote of one juror prevented a unanimous decision exonerating the Alton officials, and the court declared a mistrial with orders for a new trial.
At the fifth jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1903, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the state of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1904. The majority opinion was written by Justice James H. Cartwright.
The Alton officials' defense was confined to evidence that they had not declared their intention to violate the statute of the state, nor made a record of their illegal acts in disregard of the law. Whether their denials were true, or were due to failing memory, or to some other cause or motive, the fact that the intention was not declared does not in any manner affect the rights of the parties.
Counsel for the officials can scarcely be serious in insisting there is no evidence of any plan to discriminate. Evidence of the character contained in this record would be accepted by any impartial juror as conclusive, and the verdict can only be accounted for as a product of passion or prejudice. In such case, where the verdict clearly appears to be unsupported by the evidence, it is the duty of the court to set it aside. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in the case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the sixth jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County, 1904, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statute.
This verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1906. The unanimous decision was written by Justice Guy Scott.
Another verdict has now been returned, which also is in favor of the respondents. We have examined the evidence heard by the fourth unanimous jury and deem it unnecessary to discuss the same. The finding of the jury is against the clear preponderance thereof, and for that reason, the verdict must be set aside. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in accordance with the law as stated in this opinion and in the earlier opinions of this court in this cause.
At the seventh jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1907, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1908. Justice Cartwright, who wrote the majority opinion for the Supreme Court's 1904 decision, once again wrote the opinion for the majority.
This proceeding was commenced by the filing in this court of the petition of Scott Bibb for a writ of mandamus commanding the mayor and common council of the city of Alton to admit Minnie Bibb and Ambrose Bibb, children of the relator, to the Washington School, or the most convenient of the public schools to which they had a right to be admitted without excluding either of them on account of their color or descent. Now, the case has been again tried, and a verdict in favor of the officials, unsupported by any evidence, has been returned to this court for a fifth time. The evidence was for all intents and purposes the same as upon the former trials and demonstrated beyond the possibility of a doubt that the children of Mr. Bibb were excluded from the Washington School and that the exclusion was solely on account of their race and color. At the conclusion of the evidence, the attorney for Mr. Bibb moved the trial court to direct a verdict, finding the issues in favor of the relator. But that court denied the motion and refused to give the instruction. In so doing, the trial court erred, and the error was in a matter of law, and contrary to the law in this case declared by this court in previous opinions filed in the case.
Justice Scott, who wrote the opinion favorable to Scott Bibb's petition in his 1906 appeal, this time dissented, along with Justice Farmer. Scott wrote the dissenting opinion.
We regard the opinions filed in this case prior to the foregoing as correctly stating the law. We dissent from the judgment now entered because we believe this court is without power to render that judgment in the absence of the verdict of a jury in favor of the relator, and we do not join in the criticisms of judges and juries found in the majority opinion.
The attorney for the official says we ought to approve this verdict for the reason that the questions of fact have been tried seven times in the circuit court, and all the trials have been presided over by learned judges. We would be remiss in our duty to enforce the law and would forfeit the respect of all law-abiding citizens if we should approve this verdict for no other reason than because it is one of a series which represent not the enforcement of law,
or the discharge of duty, but a deplorable disregard for the law and for the rights of citizens. These verdicts were pronounced not by those who were avowed enemies of law and government, but by those who constituted a part of the governmental machinery for the enforcement of the law and who had been sworn to discharge their duty in that regard.
The right of the respondents to a trial by jury has been 5 times solemnly recognized by this court, and the existence of that right is expressly shown by the words of the opinion. To now deny this right with a writ of mandamus from this court because juries have persisted in returning verdicts that were not supported by the evidence is, we think, simply to make a bad matter worse.
The error of the court in refusing to direct a verdict is not obviated by the fact that there have been so many verdicts contrary to the law and the evidence. The verdict must be set aside. And the next question is whether the issue shall be again sent to the circuit court for trial.
In this case, the Alton officials seem to have enjoyed a right to a provisional or experimental trial by jury. That is to say, if the jury had found for Mr. Bibb, the officials would not have been deprived by this court of the right to a jury trial. But inasmuch as the jury found the other way, the verdict set aside and the judgment of this court is entered against the respondents without a verdict to support it.
Great weight is justly given to the conclusion of a jury upon controverted questions of fact, where the verdict appears to be the result of an honest exercise of judgment and the weighing with fair deliberation of the credibility of witnesses. But it is beyond dispute that this verdict does not represent any conclusion of the jury from the evidence, and that all of the verdicts represent nothing but a refusal by juries to enforce a law which they do not personally approve or which is distasteful to them.
If the majority regard the juries that can be obtained in Madison County and the judges who preside in the circuit court in that county as unfitted by prejudice to try the questions of fact, this court possesses the undoubted power to submit the same issues for trial to the circuit court of any other county in the state.
We are of the opinion that it would be wrong to the relator to further delay him in establishing his rights or to compel him to add to the trouble and expense already incurred. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the issues will not be again certified to the circuit court for trial, but will now be finally disposed of. We therefore find that all the material facts alleged in the petition are true as therein stated, and that Mr. Bibb is entitled to a writ of mandamus as requested. And it is therefore ordered that a peremptory writ of mandamus issue according to the petition, that the respondents pay the costs, and that execution issue therefore. Writ awarded.
Father?
Yes, Minnie.
What happened?
You're going back to school.
25 African-American students apply for enrollment to reintegrate Alton schools.
But Alton City Attorney interprets the Supreme Court's writ narrowly, applying only to the children named in the petition.
Ambrose Bibb.
And Minnie Bibb.
Even Scott Bibb's younger children were denied admission to the white schools.
Ambrose Bibb, now 21, had already moved away from Alton.
Though the Alton High School has remained integrated throughout this time, the school officials require Minnie Bibb be given an academic examination.
Minnie Bibb, now 19, is assigned to the third grade classroom.
With children half her age.
The grade she would have entered in September of 1897 when the police officers turned her away at the door.
After a short period of attendance, faced with hostility from her teacher and the children in her classroom, Minnie Bibb left Washington School.
And the Alton schools were once again segregated.
Scott Bibb organizes another boycott.
But the parents at the Douglas School refuse to take part.
The Alton Evening Telegraph runs articles vilifying Scott Bibb with claims that his efforts have left Minnie Bibb without education.
In response to the riot in Springfield, Illinois that year, the Evening Telegraph reports that vicious elements of both races are plotting that Alton may be next.
Just 2 days later in Alton, a white mob seeing a black man throw stones at a white screams they will Springfield him.
Articles in the White Alton Evening Telegraph allege that ministers of Alton's black churches advise their congregations that separate schools are sensible, providing safety along with employment for more African-American teachers.
Whites in Alton offer to buy school supplies for children attending the colored schools.
And soon, students began to fill the Lovejoy School.
By the end of that September, half of the African-American school-aged children are back in segregated schools.
Eventually, the Board of Education opened segregated annexes at the White, McKinley, and Washington schools to allay objections of blacks to sending their children to distant schools.
Scott Bibb denied the equal access that the Illinois Supreme Court ruled his family deserved, finally relents and enrolls his younger children into the segregated Washington annex.
When a Reverend Elijah Lovejoy's body was prepared for burial, William Johnson, a free black, stained his simple casket with pokeberries.
Beginning a tradition in which the black citizens of Alton would continue to care for the crusader's resting place, Johnson dug a grave in a hidden area near Lovejoy's home, marked with only a plain wooden board to protect it from being discovered and desecrated by rioters.
In recognition of Reverend Lovejoy's sacrifice and his resolve in continuing to publish his paper, although press after press was destroyed, the monument to his memory rises above Alton as a reminder of the city's historic role in the struggle for justice.
Scott Bibb and the African-American community that joined him showed the same resolve. Returning to the courtroom again and again, rejected by jury after jury, before finally winning his case before the highest court in the state of Illinois, only to lose again at the hands of elected government officials. But Scott Bibb's story was lost for decades, only recently restored by the work of historians. Not even a photograph of Bibb existed. No monument celebrated his name until February 10th, 2015, when the Board of Trustees of Lewis and Clark Community College celebrated his courage by renaming the Adult Community Learning Center on East 5th Street in Alton, Illinois, as the Scott Bibb Center.
Yeah. In 1950, 4 years before the seminal case of Brown versus the Board of Education, wherein the United States Supreme Court overturned the separate but equal doctrine of Plessy versus Ferguson, the Alton branch of the NAACP organized a campaign in which 150 African-American students attempted to register at the city's white schools, finally leading to the return of integrated classrooms over 50 years after Scott Bibb organized the boycott.
Justice Cartwright wrote in his 1908 opinion, "When the law, through the refusal of jurors to regard their oaths, becomes impotent to protect the rights of the humblest, the rights of no person are secure."
The African Americans of the Alton Citizens Committee and the Ladies Committee showed their respect for the law by using the legal means afforded them by the Constitution and statutes of Illinois to attempt to remedy their grievances. 7 juries rejected their petition.
Jurors may take heed that they obey and enforce the law, lest their refusal to enforce the law for the protection of others become effective to deprive them of their legal rights, and substitute the beliefs of jurors and courts as to the wisdom of laws enacted for their protection.
Despite the valiant efforts of Scott Bibb and the 5 favorable decisions from the Illinois Supreme Court, the system failed to protect the rights of his children and to provide them justice.
100 years later,
how are we doing? Thank you very much.
As you saw, the play depicts multiple Illinois Supreme Court education cases from 1874 to 1908, including the 5 Bibb decisions from 1897 through 1908 that prohibited segregated schools. Just a few years before the United States Supreme Court decision in 1954, the Brown versus Board of Education case, reversing the separate but equal doctrine in that landmark decision. First, just very briefly, let's start with the panelist from Carol down at the end there. How did you like the play?
Well, it was pretty emotional to me as a resident of Alton. I thought it was pretty shameful, actually. I wasn't really proud of my hometown, but I admired Scott Bibb's perseverance to keep going and persevering.
Archie Lawrence, how did you find the play? Just briefly, one word, one sentence.
I found the play to be very, it was somewhat sad in a way that what Mr. Bibb had to go through to get some form of justice, but the play was excellent.
Okay. Judge excellent. Wharton, okay. You have a connection, don't you, with Judge Wharton, with some of these folks here?
Yes, I'm a graduate of the DePaul University School of Law. Go Blue Devils.
Justice Lisa Holder-White, what do you think?
I really enjoyed the play. I thought it was very educational, and I really admire how they compressed so much information and were able to convey that very effectively.
Jennifer Hightower.
I enjoyed the play, and I thought the cast did an absolutely phenomenal job.
Let's start back with you, Carol Manning, as a representative of the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum, our host today, and an Alton, Illinois native. What are your thoughts on the play in more detail?
Well, like I said, I thought the play was wonderful. I feel like it was a great educational tool for the Springfield community. I note in the play that there were two Springfield resident references. Some of the boycott leaders met with the former governor of the state of Illinois and asked him to be, they met with John Palmer, and they retained his services on behalf of Scott Bibb. I thought that was interesting. And significantly, the play cited a namesake for the Presidential Library and Museum, then a young lawyer and Illinois legislator, Abraham Lincoln, just months after Reverend Lovejoy's murder in 1837 and a speech at the Springfield Lyceum. Lincoln alluded to Reverend Lovejoy's printing presses being thrown into the Mississippi River and Lovejoy being killed. As stated in the play, Lincoln stated in part, "Whenever the vicious portion of the population shall be permitted to gather in bands of hundreds and thousands, throw printing presses into rivers, shoot editors, depend on it, this government cannot last." Our greatest president, Abraham Lincoln, ultimately lost his life in 1865, but he made sure that our government survived the Civil War and that it did indeed last.
Archie Lawrence, as a longtime civil rights attorney and activist here in the Springfield area, and as a longtime NAACP official, what lessons do you take away from the African-American community's support of the decade-long Bibb litigation, including those set forth in the play?
The activism of the Alton Black community was prompted by their desire to maintain and expand the rights that they had achieved in the wake of the Civil War. This included post-war, federal constitutional amendments and civil rights statutes, Illinois state constitutional and statutes guaranteeing free and equal public schools, and the desegregation of Alton schools for 25 years. In its fight against the newly segregated schools of Lovejoy and Douglas, the African American community in the Alton area protested the different ways before and during the Bibb litigation. This included sit-ins at the white schools and boycotts of these schools. Numerous African-American groups supported the Bibb litigation efforts, including individuals establishing homeschooling during the boycott, such as Nettie Poindexter, church schools, ladies' committees, and men's committees supported the Bibb's efforts in numerous ways, including organized social events, picnics, and dances to raise funds throughout the country, including Springfield. As the play also related, my organization, the NAACP, brought pressure in 1950 against the segregated schools in Alton, which led to their desegregation before the landmark case of Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954. As a longtime official of the NAACP, I helped with similar fundraising to pursue civil rights litigation, and I admire the persistence of the Bibb family in this litigation.
Let's turn to Jennifer Hightower. As an attorney with the Simmons, Hanley, and Conroy firm, in Alton, and as a former student in the Alton and Edwardsville school system, how would you assess the Bibb side of the Alton school case?
Well, to briefly recap, you saw and heard the story from the perspective of Mr. Scott Bibb, and also you heard the testimony of his son, Ambrose Bibb. They're wanting to go to a school that is a mere four blocks away from their home, and they're now being forced to travel a mile away to the Lovejoy School. You also heard from additional testimony from a Mr. Cross, Mr. White, and Mr. Brock, who also had children who were forced to go to the Lovejoy or the Douglas School, which were further from their home, and their children were originally allowed to go to a school that was closer to their home. And this was all compelling testimony because they just wanted their children not only to have a great education, but to be able to go to a school that is in close proximity to their home, which is something that we, as a former student, and something that we all take for granted now because we all have go to schools or went to schools that are in close proximity to our home. You also heard the testimony of a Miss Florence Babor, who was a black teacher in the Alton School District, and she interestingly was unable to remember if the students at her school who were of mixed race were classified as colored or not. And this was something that was brought up last night at the Alton discussion because some residents felt that she was a traitor. And some residents may feel as though she was a traitor, but understandably so, she wasn't coming from the same perspective as some residents. She wasn't coming from the perspective of a parent. She was coming from the perspective of an employee. And she wanted her income. So while she may not be right, she may not also be wrong because she was just simply coming from a different perspective in the community.
Justice Lisa Holder White, you're a former assistant state's attorney, former trial judge in Macon County, now a justice on the Illinois Appellate Court here in Springfield for the 4th District. Since I've been a defense attorney, I admire that you've been an assistant public defender as well. Can I ask you to put on your defense hat, and how would you assess the Alton officials' side of the Bibb case?
Well, the factual defense of the Alton officials was, I think, very smart. It was limited and technical, and basically they removed the emotion from the case by denying the material allegations and stating this was all about overcrowding, that they were trying to alleviate overcrowding. And as part of this defense, the Alton School Board president and other officials denied the allegations regarding statements made to them, and so it became a credibility issue, and the jury had to decide who do they believe. And of course, we know who they believe.
As an appellate court justice, how did you like the play's presentation of the opinions of Justices Cartwright and Scott?
Well, I tell you, it kind of reminded me of sometimes when I get a memo on something that I've circulated and I'm hearing what someone from the other side thinks. I thought it was very theatrical and had great value in that respect. I enjoyed the back and forth presentation. That doesn't usually occur like that, even in instances where the judges do read their decisions out loud. It's just the majority decision. It's not a back and forth, and it would be only in a very significant case. But Justice Cartwright was scathing in his opinion, very well written and sharp, and you certainly left you with no wondering about how he felt about the situation. And it was interesting that the dissenting justice wanted to basically say, we don't agree with him how he's criticizing these jurors and criticizing the judges at the lower level. And so they really made a point of making that clear, and that's why they were dissenting.
Well, Justice Holder White, how did you think that the constitutional and statutory provisions were addressed by the Illinois Supreme Court in the play?
Well, they were addressed. They talked about the 1882 Supreme Court case involving the Quincy schools, and that talked about many post-Civil War laws that were put into place. And the case in McLean County, actually in Bloomington, was actually the first of three pre-Bibb cases that dealt with desegregation of the schools. And as I mentioned before, I thought the officials in Alton were clever because they basically tried to get around the law and say, well, this really has nothing to do with the fact that these children are colored children. This is about we are overcrowded. And so they basically tried to avoid the application of these laws. And under the 1870 Constitution and an 1872 statute, children between the ages of 6 to 21, and I'll quote, were entitled to a free public education. The 1874 statute said it was an act to protect colored children and their rights to attend public schools and prohibited school officials from excluding directly or indirectly any such child from the school on account of the color of the child. So they worked very hard to try to avoid dealing with what the statute actually said.
Did the Quincy Schools case address the role of the legislature in education matters?
That's not our concern. Our concern is interpreting the law and ruling based on the law as it stands. And at that time, they emphasized that the judicial branch is not the legislative branch, and they have to give deference under the doctrine of separation of powers to the legislative branch. And so if you don't like the law, if you disagree with the law, don't ask us to change it. Talk to your legislator.
Justice Holder White, should the audience's eyes sort of glaze up when they hear the word separation of powers doctrine, something they may have learned way back in history or civics class?
Well, they would be in good company because sometimes mine do, but that's all right. Not really, though. Separation of powers, it's pretty simple. It just means that we have three branches of government, and we have three branches of government for a reason. We have checks and balances, and so we want to make sure that no branch is encroaching improperly on another branch of government, and that's appropriate.
Has the separation of powers doctrine conceived by our founding fathers, is it even applicable in the 21st century?
Absolutely. I think it is applicable, and it's very important. Unfortunately, it did not work out for the Bibbs, but it is important, and when things work the way they are supposed to, then we get the proper result.
Let's turn to Judge Wharton. Let's talk about the right to trial by jury, an issue that was prominent throughout the play. As a state trial court judge in the Belleville area for more than 3 decades, 30 would be too many.
You look great.
Methuselah is sitting here as far as I can tell. During that time before your retirement in 2013, you handled thousands of cases, including hundreds of jury trials. Now, Justice Scott criticized Justice Cartwright's opinion, stating that, quote, the fixed rules of practice should not be radically altered to meet the seeming emergencies of a particular case, close quote. And under the majority's opinion, he went further to said that the Alton officials seemed to have enjoyed the right to a provisional or experimental right to trial by jury. Briefly, what was your experience with the right to trial by jurors and reaching the correct result?
I think reflective of the excellent representation provided by counsel and also assisting the judge in preparing proper instructions, I've never had a situation where I've had to disturb a jury verdict. There are situations where I may have ruled otherwise if I had been one of the jurors, but when I examined the jurors' verdict, I couldn't say that it was not based upon the evidence. This is a precious right that we enjoy. It goes all the way back to the Magna Carta, signed by King John in England in 1215. But even more than that, I think of greater significance to Americans, the jury trial was used as an early introduction to a primarily illiterate population as to democracy. They hoped that this would catch on. So we enjoy a unique relationship, a cherished relationship with the right to trial by jury.
Was the majority opinion through Justice Cartwright correct in entering judgment for Scott Bibb after 7 trials and upholding the right to a free and equal education? Or alternatively, as Justice Scott argued in his opinion, should the Supreme Court have remanded it to a case outside Madison County and therefore preserved the right to trial by jury?
This is a complicated issue because it involves two very, very important rights. The right guaranteed to the Bibbs children to have a free and equal education, and our cherished right to a trial by jury, which goes back at the time of the Bibb trial, more than 650 years. a right which involved, as I've said, elements of democracy rather than a monarchy. As has been stated by Justice White, Justice Cartwright, in no uncertain terms, wrote a scathing opinion emphasizing that if the verdicts were indeed enforced and accepted, that we would forfeit the respect of law-abiding citizens. He accused the unnamed Alton officials of being worse than anarchists, that is, people who are intent on overthrowing the government. He also directly rebuked the jurors for not enforcing the 1874 statute because they found it distasteful. In addition, Justice Cartwright distinguished Justice Scott's experimental or provisional right argument by concluding that the right to a trial by jury was not recognized under common law, in that mandamus actions were basically equitable actions to which no right to a jury trial attached, and that the constitutional right to a jury trial only applied to those cases which had recognized a right to a jury trial applying prior to the enactment of our Illinois state constitution. As to further discuss the proposal that the case be transferred to another county, I think that, in my opinion, that would have been very nebulous because due to the times, you couldn't find maybe another county that would be even as receptive as Madison County was. I think that to uphold the integrity of the court and also to give the Bibb's children some degree of equality and justice, the Supreme Court did what it did, and I favor Justice Cartwright's opinion, recognizing that if they had delayed it another 2 years, then even many would have probably been too old to go to school.
One legal concept worth mentioning is what we would call the law of the case doctrine. This is where a lower tier court is bound by precedent of the higher tier court, here the trial court and the Illinois Supreme Court. The Bibb trial judges were bound by the Bibb Supreme Court decisions. Justice Scott emphasized this concept by saying, a right to trial by jury has been solemnly recognized by the court, and the existence of the right is expressly shown by the words of the opinion. To now deny this right with a writ of mandamus is to make a bad matter worse. Stated differently, Justice Scott believed that by entering an order for the Bibbs without a favorable jury verdict would make the discrimination issue worse. Sadly, that prediction turned out to be true, as Alton schools remained segregated until the 1950s.
One other legal issue arises from the Alton city attorney narrowly construing the 1908 opinion, only applying it to the Bibb children, but not to other black children similarly situated. That was because of the relator issue that you heard here, which the petition was signed by Scott Bibb only, but no other black parents. It's interesting here to play Monday morning quarterback and question whether or not a mistake was arguably made by not including more black parents in the lawsuit, and then theoretically having a broader opinion from the Supreme Court on the mandamus issue, which potentially might have made it more difficult for the Alton officials to evade the Illinois Supreme Court opinion. Now, by doing so under this theory, history would have been changed and the Alton schools reintegrated before the 1950s. However, this procedural mechanism could have potentially come at a significant cost, and that would be including lengthening the trials, and obviously they were very long and very numerous, as we've heard, seven in number. But subjecting the school children themselves, as well as the parents of the school children, to Scott Bibb-type criticism, as well as the rigors of trial testimony, as you saw here from Ambrose Bibb himself. Now, turning to contemporary time period today, this situation would most likely not occur. Today we have class action lawsuits where you have multiple parties that have filed suit. Justice Holder White has done some great research for us in this particular regard. And in addition, the courts have construed their powers, particularly their equitable powers, broader than occurred in the court between 1898 on the opinion, or 1899 actually, the first opinion, through 1908, in which they had that more conservative interpretation of the separation of powers. So Stated differently, today we probably would not have the same problem that existed back then, but it is an interesting Monday morning quarterback issue as to whether or not back then the issue could have been resolved at an earlier time period.
Archie Lawrence, let's go back to you. Scott Bibb was publicly criticized for boycotting the Alton school system with his children, Ambrose and Minnie, by taking them out of the Alton school system and homeschooling them, and then after the 1908 opinion, sending his younger children to Alton segregated schools. Do you think this criticism is fair?
No, I really don't. For one, when any litigation process, it can be very emotional, it can be very stressful, and very expensive and draining. And for him to do this, I'm certain he was a subject to of emotional distress, and Scott, Ambrose, and Minnie Bibb. And this was for almost a decade, and I have never had a case. Thank God, I have never had a case that would go for 10 years. And also, he had pressures coming from the black community as well. And those pressures were that they had built the Lovejoy and Douglas schools, and that it was an employment thing as well, because you didn't have any black teachers, but any black teachers were in the Lovejoy and Douglas schools, and they wanted to stay employed as well. So after a while, I guess Mr. Bibb decided that the fight simply wasn't worth it.
We should note that Scott Bibb actually died in 1910, in his early 50s. So the stress certainly weighed on him.
Judge Wharton, based on your academic background and your experience, what are the benefits of an integrated school system?
By way of background, both Attorney Archie Lawrence and I graduated from the same high school, Lincoln Senior High School in East St. Louis. Mm-hmm. He came a little bit after me, though. It was maybe not so segregated as you might think, because I can recall a Jewish family sent their son to Lincoln, and he's doing very well, and he credits the great education that he received at Lincoln Senior High School. So it wasn't completely segregated. The fascinating thing about the school was that master's degrees were quite common. Almost anyone in the school who had taught for any period of time had a master's degree, and we had a substantial number of our educators had doctorals in high school. But that was a different time and a different age. We recognize that now, in the global economy, all of our students have to be comfortable to associate, to work with a diverse group of people. And that's an important asset. We need to educate our students to compete against foreign students. And in doing so, we have to think outside the box. That is, to recognize that there's no such thing as one size fits all in education. The more alternatives and varieties of educational programs we have available, the more effective we're going to be in producing the students who can compete. And there are some great examples of what's going on thinking outside the box. The military schools, which have probably the most diverse population of students, are doing an excellent job with some very innovative programs. In Chicago, there are two predominantly African-American schools, predominantly, not totally, that are same-sex schools. There is the Urban Prep Academy, which is for boys, and then there's the Young Women's Leadership Charter School, which is for girls, and they have an excellent record. We can think of more innovative things to do without violating the spirit or letter of Bibb or Brown versus the Board of Education.
Let's turn to our two former Alton residents, Carol Manning and Jennifer Hightower, and discuss their education in the Alton school system. Carol, before joining ALPLM as an education coordinator in 2005, you received your bachelor's and master's degree from Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville. How did your education experience in Alton schools before college differ from what you've seen in the Bibb play?
Well, I attended integrated parochial schools in Alton from the 50s to the 60s, and although there was a limited number of African-American families with whom I came in contact with at those schools, when I attended SIU Edwardsville, I came and had greater interaction with blacks. As a longtime Alton resident, it was painful to watch the Bibb case and watch the events that happened to the Bibb children and the treatment by the Alton community. I can identify with the play's depiction of the collapsing of the Alton community, which has since included the closing of the glassworks where Scott Bibb worked. There were also four major factories in Alton that closed, and it was a blue-collar town. There was most people were employed. Many African males, that was their place of employment that they lost. I also note that my former hometown experienced a troubling 28% reduction in population. In 1960, the population was 42,000. By 2010, it was down to 28,000. So we're hopeful that at some point, maybe this can be reversed and the population decline reversed.
Have you stayed in touch with any educator in the Alton school system? And if so, briefly, what are the views on race relations in the school system today?
Well, a friend of mine has taught in the Alton Public Schools for over 30 years, and she said that the Alton school system works very hard to maintain positive race relations. They have a mentoring system for students where a social worker will come and meet with students. Usually it's a male, and they help students with have difficulties with lack of parenting or stability at home. So they also have support systems for the schools themselves. So they seek proactively to limit the race issues in the Alton school system.
Jennifer Hightower, you also attended an integrated school system in both Alton and Edwardsville. Please tell us your experience as an African-American woman in those schools, and could it have been improved more with even greater diversity of students in your earlier years?
My dad was an educator in the Alton school system for 21 years. We moved to another town very close to us, to Edwardsville. He took over the school system in Edwardsville when I was in high school, but I moved from a school system that was 60-30 or 65-35 to an area that was almost all white. And in my classroom situation in Alton, I was the only black student or one of two. So it became very, very difficult. Most students were nice. It wasn't a situation where I was tormented or teased or bullied, but you want someone, and it's very helpful when you find someone that looks like you and you have someone that you can relate to.
Jennifer, have you stayed in contact with other folks in the school community, and what is their view of the race relations in the Alton community at the present time?
I do. I live in Alton. My family lives in Edwardsville, but I live in Alton, and many of my colleagues at the law firm where I work, they have children in the Alton school system. Race relations are on the mind of everyone in the tables across the country. I think that with open dialogue and with acceptance, I think the race relations can improve. But it's going to take it's going to take some work, not just in Alton, but everywhere. And I think we as a community in Alton, and we as a community across the country, we can do it if we work together.
The play started with the dedication of Reverend Elijah Lovejoy's monument in 1897, 60 years after the white minister was murdered by the mob for his anti-slavery writings. Now the play finished with him and a look to the future. Jennifer, we're not asking you to assume the mantle of an entire generation. Certainly the diversity of your generation is so substantial, maybe unparalleled in American history. But as the youngest member of this panel, and before we take some questions, do you have any closing thoughts for the audience?
Pressure, Scott. No, I do think that there is some irony in the fact that at the 1897 dedication that two all-black schools were open, and the names of those schools. Those two schools were named after Frederick Douglass, an abolitionist, and they were also named after Reverend Elijah P. Lovejoy. I think there's definitely some irony in the names of those schools. I think that we also must take a moment and pay homage to Scott Bibb, and the fact that the renaming of the Alton Learning Center after Scott Bibb is finally giving him the credit and the honor that his work deserves. And I think that, you know, race relations can, like I said, race relations can and will improve. I think we as a community, we as a country, must understand and realize that education, there needs to be equality in education, but in order for that to happen, there's a lot of room to go, there's a lot of room to grow, and as Judge Wharton said we must think outside of the box, and if we do that, we can get there.
That's a good ending point to see if there's any questions from the audience.
Thank you. Hello, my name is George Tinkham. I'm a practicing attorney here in Springfield. The last time I spent time with Steve Beckett, we were on the Lincoln Circuit ride. I led a motorcycle group along the old H Judicial Circuit, and Steve and his wife were gracious enough to tell us about Lincoln in the Urbana area.
That's right.
So it's good seeing you again.
Good to see you.
One of the things that Judge Wharton touched on, but I just can't understand, is this whole jury business. I've handled dozens and dozens of mandamus and injunction cases, and I have never gone before a jury. What changed in the law? Why were they so hung up with a jury trial? This wouldn't happen today. Please help me understand.
I think that one thing that you see going on now is a struggle for the Supreme Court to basically develop its authority. This is a terrible time in our country's history. There are killings, race riots, there is just all kinds of lawlessness. And I think that what you saw was a lower court that, as a result of other cases where the Supreme Court's wishes had been disobeyed, felt empowered to do the same thing and that there would be no repercussions. I really felt, in reading this, that this was a situation where the Supreme Court had ordered, or almost ordered, the court to direct the verdict, and they turned around and did something totally against that. This was a contemptuous situation. I can't see why the Supreme Court didn't act to find them in contempt of court, call that trial judge up. So I think that maybe there was some hesitancy at that time, but still, it was pretty much a very crucial time for the justice system. And as we saw later on, when all the race riots broke out, primarily in the North, and all the killings and all of the lawlessness, this was a serious time for our justice system.
I think that it's probably the case that cases like this one led the General Assembly to revise the Mandamus Act. There is a Mandamus Act to revise the Injunction Act, to take away a right to trial by jury that was thought to be required under the 1870 Constitution, but that ultimately the court said it just doesn't apply.
And Cartwright discusses in his opinion that they don't have a right to a jury trial.
Exactly.
But then we get to the law of the case issue. Well, they've had jury trials, so it would be unfair to deprive them of that at this time. But Cartwright speaks to that and says, you know, they don't even have a right to a jury trial in this. Yeah.
Any other questions here? Don't be bashful. Thank you. Identify yourself, sir.
I'm Terry Corrigan. I'm with the Attorney General's office.
Glad to have you aboard here.
I just was wondering if anybody knew how common among the states in the late 1800s it was to have similar statutes banning segregation in schools.
There were quite a few states that did ban segregation in that particular regard. It was mentioned that in the Plessy versus Ferguson one, there was a reference to certain states that did have segregated schools, but there were also a host of other states that prohibited that. That eventually became the majority view years later. But there were some in the late 1800s. Any other questions?
In the back there.
This is not really a question as much as a comment. My name is Barbara Dickerman. I'm part of the NAACP and the African American History Museum in Springfield. If Alton schools were fully or pretty much integrated in the 1950, Springfield was nowhere near, because Archie Lawrence was certainly a part of a lawsuit in what, Archie, maybe 76 to integrate the Springfield schools. You might make a little, you'll remember more about that than I do, maybe.
Okay, in regards to that, it was 1984 when ultimately the former government was changed from a council system to a ward system. And that was the indication as to just how far we had to go And in the meantime, the school system here in Springfield was totally integrated. While it was on its face integrated de jure, but in fact it wasn't, because most of the black kids attended schools across 11th Street. You had Palmer, for one, that was all black, and you had Fischens and all of them, and that's where most of the black kids went. Now, obviously, there was a few black kids that went to Springfield High and all those places, but the school system was in a lot of ways still segregated. And for that reason, they had, the school system was sued, and I was trying to think of the lead plaintiff in the case, but Val McCary was one of them. And they sued the Springfield School District, and basically it was on the basis that they had little or no black teachers, they had few black employees, even in the black schools, and the black teachers were not allowed to transfer as others would do that. So, for that reason, Springfield still had a long way to go, and it was even in 84. In fact, we're still fighting under that case right now because they've never reached the goal that was set out in that case.
You know, still, the NAACP is still working to get the black teachers, a decent right. amount of black teachers in the schools.
Exactly.
Any other questions? Then we thank everybody for spending part of your Tuesday night with us. Thank you.
You're watching the Illinois Channel, an independent nonprofit corporation formed to provide gavel-to-gavel coverage of Illinois state government and other public affairs events taking place across Illinois.